It's showtime. I love to say that every time we start recording. Anyway, okay, welcome. So I'm really happy to see you all here. My name is Dario. I'm the usual host of the Kubernetes Multi-tenancy Meetup. And today I'm here also with Yves. I try to say that in the right way. Please confirm that, Yves, because it's a pain to me, remember the right pronunciation. Also because my name is always butchered because it's really hard. Not the name, but especially the surname. So Tranquitella, but never mind. So we are here today because we are doing real cool stuff regarding multi-tenancy. So a quick recap of what we're doing here. So this is a meetup where we talk about multi-cluster, multi-tenancy, and we talk also how to address multi-tenancy in several ways. And what is multi-tenancy in a nutshell? So you got a Kubernetes cluster. This Kubernetes cluster is used by many tenants. So what is a tenant? We are going to describe that. But keep in mind that when you're addressing multi-tenancy, there are so many shades of gray that you have to take care of. You got the networking, you got the storage, you got the classes. So when you got a single cluster, everything is fine because in the end, you're totally offloading the management and the provisioning of the cluster to the DevOps or to the developers. And when you instead have to deal with multi-tenancy, you have to take care of the whole picture and prevent privileged escalation. You have to play very well also regarding security, but mostly one of the tough job in a Kubernetes cluster is the storage. I still remember that. I've been a site rabbit engineer, so I'll start providing a story about myself. And one of the most critical stuff to do in a cluster was taking care of the state of your applications, especially when these applications were storing data regarding customers. And obviously, you know, you cannot lose the customer's data because otherwise you're going to lose the confidence of the customers itself. So you're spending a lot of money to get new customers. You just need to lose one customer data and you are going to lose all the customers on your platform. So I'm really happy to be here because we are going to provide a brief overview of what is Capsule regarding multi-tenancy. And then we are going to get also a nice presentation regarding Trident or Trident, Yves. Can you unmute yourself? Trident, okay, that's yes. Great. Okay, Trident, you know. Also because in Italian, I would say Trident, but jokes apart, let's start talking about what is Capsule. So I can pass the word to Yves to explain what he's doing. So let's see what is Capsule. So Capsule is an open source operator. So it means that it's a component that is installed in your Kubernetes cluster that is addressing the multi-tenancy. So what is the multi-tenancy? As already described, is when you got a Kubernetes cluster that is going to be shared across multiple tenants. So what are tenants? Tenants could be users, a group of users, or also service accounts when you're building a platform. Keep in mind that in the end, it's like having one person that is going to use a slice of your Kubernetes cluster. So the design regarding multi-tenancy is pretty pretty common, especially when you are building a platform, a container as a service platform, or eventually one of the latest hype regarding the internal developer platform. So when you have to build a platform as a service for your own company. So let's imagine I got the developers, they are pushing the code and they want to get it deployed automatically. In that case, we are talking about a platform, something like OpenShift, but obviously not strictly related to the Red Hat OpenShift. Or eventually also another use case that we saw with Capsule, because right now we are pretty happy because we are seeing a lot of adoptions. KubeCon is coming, is upcoming, and we are looking forward to meet also people that are using in production. And there is a use case with Wargaming where they were able to use Capsule to create a platform where the tenants were bringing their own node pools. So a sort of mimicking what is a managed service, because in the end, you just need to bring your nodes. These nodes are joining the cluster and your workloads is going to be placed there. And we presented that at the KubeCon EU 2021. It was the virtual version. And it was really interesting because I and Max Fedotov, that is also a core maintainer of Capsule. And if you have the chance, you can find the video on YouTube. You just need to type KubeCon Capsule and there you go. But let's talk about multi-tenancy because otherwise I can tell stories for long hours. Anyway, there is the multi-tenancy dilemma. And as I said, we have to try to understand what is multi-tenancy. And you know, for who knows me, I do a lot of memes. And unfortunately, this great meme has not been crafted by me, but in a nutshell, explain what is multi-tenancy. So we got this cluster. We are expecting to get all our resources correctly allocated, but in the end, we end up with a mess because it's really hard to use the same concepts, well, the same primitives offered by Kubernetes to create a multi-tenant architecture. Luckily, in the last couple of years, also the community started working on the concept of multi-tenancy. There is a new track, the KubeCon, in Detroit 2022 in North America, where we are going to talk about multi-tenancy. There is also Capsule that is being mentioned in the Kubernetes documentation as a solution to offer multi-tenancy. But keep in mind that in Kubernetes, essentially, we got something that is not entirely multi-tenant. So I'd say that the multi-tenant level is the bare namespace. So you know that in Kubernetes, you can create how many namespaces as you want, but these are flat. It means that you can create just a single namespace, but you cannot create a tenant. So a sort of collection of your own namespaces. In that case, the solution is to say, okay, you can create your own cluster. So it means that you're ending up with multiple namespaces on your own. But before proceeding, let's say that Kubernetes is already aware and is offering these objects to address the multi-tenancy. And these basic primitives are the limit range, network policy, resource quota, and obviously namespaces. And all of these objects combined together, they allow to create a sort of tenancy because with the limit range, you can say, okay, I have to set resources for storage, for my pod, for my containers. With network policy, we are going to create segmentation at the network level. So we avoid to let the tenant owners to the tenant workloads to start polling other services, starting creating a mess on the network stack and so on and so forth. And with the resource quota, we can say, okay, with resource quota, this namespace cannot exceed some amount of memory, of CPU, of storage, and so on and so forth. And all this stuff is binded together using the RBAC, the role-based access control. So in the end, we need to try to combine everything, all the primitives that Kubernetes is offering us, to create a simple API that allows to create us the tenants. But obviously, there are plenty of shades regarding multi-tenancy solutions. I'd say that we can try to elaborate a bit more just these three ones. So the one cluster per app, it's something that I saw in the last couple of months, I'd say also years, because it's the correct approach if you want to be sure that you got network isolation, virtual machines isolation, eventually also hypervisor isolation, and also Kubernetes cluster isolation. It's really great because in the end, creating a cluster right now is really easy peasy lemon squeezy. You can use cluster API, you can use KubeADM, or eventually you can use also the managed service. But obviously, there is a downside, and the downside is the cost. I'm not just talking about the virtual machines that you have to pay for, but also the operational burden. I've been there, I know what it means. Taking care of large clusters, or eventually taking care of multiple clusters. You can try to automate everything, but you know, in the end, Murphy's Law, it happens. So you have to prepare yourself. Otherwise, what you can do is to create one cluster, sorry for the typo, per team. it means that will be great, because let's see, we got our tenant is taking care of multiple applications. They can take care of the applications and of the cluster too. But when you got one tenant, two tenants, three tenants, it's linear exponential. So in the end, you're ending up also to say, how can we create standards between the tenants? So it means that we have to try to create policies that are cluster-wide, so multi-cluster, and it could be really, really cumbersome. So it means that we are missing the shared processes and the methodology using instead of a shared cluster. So the idea behind the shared cluster is to say, okay, we can use a single cluster. We create an abstraction named tenant. And this tenant, what is? Essentially, it's just a collection of namespaces. And these namespaces can be operated by a tenant owner. So this is one of the persona that we define in our jargon. So it means that I'm the admin of these namespaces, so I can create pods, workloads, services, whatever I need to operate my business. And obviously, I'm trying to be a meme master, and this is one of the old ones. Adriano, still remember that. And I've been, and I'm still a huge fan of Lord of the Rings. So one cluster rules them all, one tenant to find them, and one cube config to bring them all, and in the darkness bind them. So this is Lord of the Rings, but say it should be the Lord of the clusters, and we are trying to tackle that. But jokes apart, and sorry for that, it's my fault. Let's try to understand from the theoretical point of view how Capsule works. Then don't worry, we are going to have a quick demo, because you know a demo is more worth than a thousand of slides. And obviously, since we are talking about multi-tenancy, the concept behind multi-tenancy is that we are going to have a set of users. So it means that we have to identify users. And you know that in Kubernetes, we don't have the concept of users and groups. Well, we got it, but these are not first-class citizens in Kubernetes. When you create the RBAC, when you create a role binding, across the role binding, you can assign a subject. And in the subject, you can specify the user, you can specify the group, and so on and so forth. So what we are saying is that when you're addressing multi-tenancy, we have to identify users. And in Kubernetes, you got, I'd say, two ways to do that. Using an external provider like OIDC, so an identity provider, or eventually using a TLS certificate. TLS certificates are so 90-ish. They are still working. They are rocking the world, but you know, they are not so much flexible. And we strongly suggest to use an identity provider, and especially OIDC. So it means that in the end, we got our cluster, we got our users that are interacting with a kubeconfig. In the kubeconfig, they got all the details to authenticate against the API server. And we intercept the request saying, okay, this request has been made by Dario, that is part of the group CLASTIX system authenticated, and so on and so forth. So being able to say, these are the users that must obey to the multi-tenancy solution that we are designing on top of Kubernetes is the entry point. And obviously, keep in mind that Capsule has been designed to be totally self-service. So in the past, I remember that I saw a lot of companies saying, okay, you have to create a new project for the platform, you open a ticket. No way, absolutely. I mean, you can do that, obviously, because if you got process, you have to obey them. But the idea behind Capsule is that everything can be automatically offloaded to the developer. So the developer just need to create namespaces, and these namespaces are going to be binded to the specified tenant. And this is possible thanks to the cluster role that we created when you are installing Capsule. And we are going to see that is named Capsule Namespace Provisioner. So in the end, we are saying that the user, Dario, being part of Capsule Classic IO group or any other group you can specify, is able to create these namespaces. But obviously, this is not enough. And we need to use also webhooks. So what are webhooks? They are pretty famous right now in Kubernetes because they allow us to create policies. And we saw the rise of open policy agent like Gatekeeper. We saw also Kiverno. there are plenty of them. You can write also your own. And keep in mind that Capsule is offering its own policy engine. And this policy engine allows to create the connection between the request of the users subjected to the multi-tenancy by denying or not the request, or eventually also adding some fields. And we will see how it works. Keep in mind that anyway, we play really well as Capsule with the other policy engines. We had a nice chat also in a previous special community call with Jim by Kiverno. It was really interesting. We got people that are using that and are extending the Capsule capabilities. So it's not, it's a win-win solution, I'd say, Capsule, Kiverno, or eventually any other policy engine out there. But since we are talking about webhooks, how can we create a connection from the namespace to the tenant? So keep in mind that obviously tenant is a concept that is cluster-wide. So the tenant is something that is going to be configured by the platform administrator. So the platform administrator is another persona in our jargon. So it's the one that is taking care of the whole platform. So we have to create this connection, and the connection is made possible by the owner reference. So the owner reference is a sort of saying, hey, I'm a foreign key constraint between the tenant and the namespace. And it's pretty similar, I'd say, also the same that we can see with the basic concept of a workload on Kubernetes, the pod. So the pod is controlled by a replica set, and then the replica set is controlled by deployment. And we can create these chains of notification and reconciliation. And that's great because in the end, mutating the creation request, we can add the owner reference. So we are binding the namespace to the tenant. But obviously, how can we define the tenants? You know all that Kubernetes is made of YAML. Also, the code base is made of YAML. Just joking, that's not true. It's written in Go. But obviously, we have to create resources, and these resources are going to be created using YAML specifications. So Kubernetes, since the first release, offered the way to create custom resource definitions, CRDs. And essentially, these are OpenAPI v3 specifications that are injected at runtime in the API server, and it allows you to extend the capabilities of Kubernetes itself using the operator pattern. So, too many words, I'd say. Keep in mind that we got just a single CRD for Capsule, that is the tenant CRD, where you can define all the rules applied to a tenant. And the developer just need to issue kubectl create namespace and then the name of the namespace for your tenant. So we are not expecting any third-party plugin, no custom binaries. We are sticking to the real and native Kubernetes developer experience. It has been designed from the beginning. We didn't want to complicate things because we strongly believe that Kubernetes, to be honest, is already complex by design. And we don't want to add further complexity, further burden to the developers that need to study additional plugins, additional binaries, and so on and so forth. But anyway, it's much more enjoyable trying to see a demo. So as you can see here, maybe I can try to increase the screen. I created a cluster here. So what is a cluster here? It's kind. Kind is the acronym of Kubernetes in Docker. So locally, I use a lot kind, especially for the end-to-end test suite of Capsule, but also for development purposes. Keep in mind that in the end, we are going to get a single container, and this container is a CNCF compliant Kubernetes cluster. In fact, I can issue cluster info. And as you can see here, we got our mapping here. Docker, yes, many, I, kind control plane. Here it is. And I can issue all my commands. It means that in my current context, I am the admin. So here I am the platform administrator, the platform admin. And how can I install Capsule? It's pretty straightforward because what I have to issue is install Capsule. Capsule in CLASTIX Capsule. And I'm going to install it using helm. In this case, I'm issuing helm upgrade. In case you're missing, install the release capsule from CLASTIX capsule minus n capsule system create namespace. Keep in mind that this is the first time, if it's the first time that you're installing capsule, you just need to type helm repo add CLASTIX. So with this command, you're downloading a copy of our helm charts, and you can manage the installation of the capsule release with all the parameters, all the values, and so on and so forth. Now, just for the sake of simplicity, we are installing with the default values. And our capsule will be installed in the capsule system namespace. I'm going to create another pane just to show you that we are getting the capsule system. I'm switching the context and show you what we are ending up. So we got the controller manager, the capsule controller manager one, that is waiting for the certificates to be deployed. Why this? Because when you're dealing with the dynamic admission controllers, like validating and mutating the books required for the policy engine, the capsule policy engine, you need to be sure that the connection between the API server and the capsule operator are secured by design. And once we got the certificates, because obviously we have to generate a CA, we have to generate the certificate and so on and so forth, we can start working with capsule. So what I can do is to say, get CRDs. And as you can see here, we got the tenants and the capsule configuration. So we are really in love with Kubernetes. We strongly believe that Kubernetes must be operated in the Kubernetes way, that we are configuring capsule using a CRD. Yeah. It's a sort of inception here. But keep in mind that right now, what we can do is to try to create a tenant. So since I'm here, the cluster administrator, what I can do is to say kubectl apply minus f, the API version, capsule.classics.io v1 beta 1. The kind is a tenant. Metadata, we can specify the name that is going to be solar. And I'm going to set also the specification of the tenant. And the first and the only required property is owners, because we have to specify the owners. For our CI, for our demos, we always say that we are going to use a user named Alice. And as you can see here, we got our tenant created, solar. Status is active. We don't have any namespace quota, any namespace count, node selector, just an age. And there is also this nice trick. You can issue TNT tenant, because capture is a bomb, it's explosive. So yeah. Jokes everywhere. So right now we got our tenant. So far, so good. So what I can do is to, as a cluster administrator, say, I can put me on watch and using another pane saying, okay, I'm Alice and now I want to create a namespace. So what I can do right now is that, keep in mind that I'm using kind. I don't have any identity provider configured here. I can create certificates, or eventually I can use also user impersonation here. So I'm saying that I'm going to be as user Alice, part of the as group capsule.classics.io, and I'm going to check how can I create namespace. Oh, my bad, as Alice. And as you can see here, my subject assets review is confirming that I can create namespace. So again, what I can do is to say kubectl as Alice as group capsule classics.io create namespace solar development. And as you can see here, our request has been bounded to the tenant. So here, if I try to say k get tenant solar minus all YAML, we are getting in the status a list of namespaces. So solar development has been bounded to the tenant solar because Alice is bounded to a tenant. So what happens if we try to create a namespace, not like Alice, but maybe like Bob, of the group capsule classix.io? Let's say, let's create solar staging. Obviously, we cannot, because we don't have any tenant assigned to Bob or eventually to the Bob's group. So we are identifying the request. We are doing a lookup in the tenants list. And upon that, we try to connect the namespace to the tenant. And so far, so good. So let's say that now Alice can create many namespaces. So we are ending up with staging and production. And all our namespaces are bounded to solar. But obviously, we have to put in place some policies. And the most simple one to show you all is the following one. So we can edit the tenant solar. We can enter in specification and specify namespace options, specifying a quota of 3 namespaces. Keep in mind that I don't remember all the keywords of the capsule, but we craft a nice website named capsuleclassix.io where you can find all the information regarding the API. You can get also a tutorial, references, and you just need to type namespace quota or eventually quota, and you define all the information regarding a quota or eventually also the enforcement that you are looking for. So now what happens if I try as Alice to create an additional namespace like QA? Obviously, we cannot, because we reached the quota. It means that we have to try to connect to the platform administrator and asking to create, to get a new quota, or eventually what I can do is to delete also one of my old namespaces just to get enough room. And keep in mind that I didn't show you that as Alice, as group capsule.classix.io, how can I create deployment in the namespace solar development? The answer is yes, because automatically Capsule is creating all the RBAC required to use the resources that 99% of the developers are expecting, like services, ingresses, deployments, replica sets, config map, and whatever you want. Obviously, since we are talking about a platform, since we are talking about namespaces, we don't allow to create cluster scope resources, because this would be too much, this would be out of scope, because in the end, the tenant is just a collection of namespaces. But in the case of storage, you know that we got in the storage in Kubernetes, we got PB, persistent volumes, and we got also persistent volume claims. And with the persistent volume claims, an application could require a persistent volume that is going to be provisioned by a CSI, but I'm pretty sure that Yves is going to explain everything really, really well. Keep in mind that in the end with Capsule, just for the sake of timing, I'm going to use the kubectl explain tenant specification. We can define a lot of options. Like we can specify which storage classes a tenant can use. So with this, you can create some boundaries. You can create tiering of the tenants. And this is really great, because in the end, you're ending up as a sort of platform for your own teams. You can specify also resource quotas. And this is great because, you know, resource quota are objects that are namespace scope. It means that the quotas that you're defining regarding the amount of CPU and memory defined there are just applied to the namespace. But with Capsule, we didn't implement any new custom resource object, custom resource definition, any new object, but we try to reuse the official object, the resource quota, just to make them aware of the tenants. So if you're going to specify some quotas, these quotas are going to be applied to just your tenant. It's something that is available, for example, on OpenShift, where you can specify cluster resource quota, but that will be too much opinionated because it's applicable just to name to OpenShift, and said capsule can work on any distribution. It works on vanilla Kubernetes, is working on Rancher, is working on AKS, on EKS, any distribution. And we had also people from Red Hat that contributed to Capsule and are using Capsule on top of OpenShift. So we are really happy because in the end, we are providing a framework to build your own multi-tenancy. We are not opinionated. We are always looking for feedback, for feature requests. And when we have also the chance to try to work together with other realities like NetApp, we are really happy. And with that said, maybe I think that we can try to wrap up here the demo. Just keep in mind that Capsule is open source Apache 2 license. These are the GitHub's links. We got also, I forgot to say that, and we can upload the link also on the video. We got also the thematic channel on the Kubernetes Slack workspace. You just need to find for hashtag Capsule. You can talk directly to us as CLASTIX, but also to the maintainers. And Capsule right now has been released to version 0.1.2. And don't be shy. It's not a major, but actually Capsule is production grade. We know customers that are using with success. We are helping also customers on using Capsule to address production grade cases. And we are working really hard to release the 0.2.0. And keep in mind that we are going to introduce a new API version. Right now, the tenants definition is V1 beta 1. We are working for the V1 beta 2. And we are adding some new features. And one of the most exciting one is the replication across tenants. So let's imagine that you need to get a namespace or eventually also another object that must be replicated across a set of tenants, or eventually replicate resources across all the namespaces of your old tenant. It's a use case that we saw from the feature requests asked by the community. So please don't be shy. If you have any question, any feature request, just open an issue. Let's start a discussion. We are totally committed to the open source. And it means that with that said, it means that we strongly believe in a shared governance approach of Capsule. But before proceeding, I will pass the word. So I'm stopping sharing my screen to Yves so he can start showing us the super capabilities of Trident and NetApp.
Thank you for that. So let me share my screen also. I think it should be okay right now, just for the check.
Yeah, we can see the screen.
Great. So my name is Yves. I'm based in France. I work for NetApp, and I'm happy to be part of this meetup today. I started working or playing around with CLASTIX and Capsule a few months back. I guess in my role as a solution architect, it's not only about selling NetApp solutions, it's also to see how we can use our product with what's out there. And Kubernetes for me is like a Lego. I like to play with it and it's fun, right? But for those of you who don't know who NetApp is actually, because some may not know us, NetApp is a 30-year-old company, and believe or not, we were created in a garage back in the time in California. But what is our role? Well, our role is about being the specialist of data. We can manage your data, protect your data, secure your data, move your data wherever it is, and used for whatever application, whatever use case you have, anywhere, on premises or in the different hyperscalers. That said, Kubernetes can be one of these use cases. And following what you said earlier, in the early days of Kubernetes, so let's say in 2014 to 2016, You said, Dario, that storage was difficult, and you are totally right. And if you remember the different surveys issued by the CNCF at the time, storage was the number one challenge three years in a row. So it's logic that, or natural, that NetApp as data specialists, we thought it would be probably a good idea to release something to the market to ease this pain. So, and it's true that when you look at Kubernetes and applications and pods, it's all made of moving objects, right? Whereas storage or data, it's very sticky. It's very linked to the media where it sits. So you have two worlds that are totally opposite. So in 2016, we created Trident. NetApp was the first company to create a storage provisioner to dynamically create volumes for Kubernetes. And that was 6 years ago. That was the beginning of our journey for Kubernetes. And since then, we have created many different other solutions and products that will help you answer different challenges. Persistence, troubleshooting, protection, application management, and so on. Monitoring also, and still on-premises and in the cloud. Now, when it comes to Trident, because it is the topic of the day for me. So Trident, it's again, a storage provisioner for Kubernetes. It is fully open source, available on GitHub, on the NetApp page. It is, at no extra cost then, and it's fully maintained and supported by NetApp. Again, it is supported by NetApp, which means that if you use Trident and you have an issue, you can simply either open a case with NetApp or open a GitHub case also. But Trident is a storage provisioner. It doesn't host the data. So where is it going to create volumes? It will create volumes on any storage system, which can be appliance, storage, software defined, or service in the cloud that you have at hand, and that is NetApp. So data center or the cloud. Also, again, Trident was created 6 years ago, but in between, the CSI standard was created. CSI stands for Container Storage Interface. And the idea behind that was to create a standard so that all the storage vendors could define or provide their features to the Kubernetes users through the same channel. So as long as you know how to use a storage class in Kubernetes, you are fine with any storage provider. And it is the storage provider to bring you more nice features. So just in a nutshell, how does that work? Let's say you are an IT admin. You configure your different storage backends that again can be in a data center, software-defined environment, or in the cloud. You install Trident in Kubernetes. And again, when I say Kubernetes, it can be any orchestrator based on Kubernetes. So OpenShift, Rancher, GKE, AKS, EKS, and so on, even Tanzu. So we will see in the demo later how to install Trident and how easy it is. Anyway, you configure the storage backend, you install Trident in Kubernetes, and you create different Trident backends, which will define what kind of objects you are going to create on the storage backend. By object, I mean an NFS share, for instance, on an iSCSI LUN, depending if you want file or block environment. And finally, you will create different storage classes which have different capabilities. Do I want to enable volume expansion? Do I want to have a fast storage? Do I want to have a low storage? Different features. When that is done, I guess the admin can do something else. Comes in the picture the developer or the application, which will create or request a PVC, which stands for persistent volume claim, because the end user doesn't have access directly to the storage. So the developer will create this PVC, which comes with four different minimal parameters: a name, a size, an access mode, and the storage class you want to use, and that's all. Once you have done that, Trident will see the request come in, will look at the different backends available and physically create the volume where it should be. And finally, create the Kubernetes persistent volume object, the PV, and link the PVC to the PV. And this is done totally dynamically. meaning the developer doesn't have to ask beforehand to the admin, please create me 20 volumes so that I can use them whenever I want. No, because that is cumbersome. It adds a lot of load on the admins, the storage admin on their shoulders. They don't like that. The developers like to have storage when they want, use it when they want, how they want. So it is done totally dynamically. In terms of features, well, Trident does much more than just creating volumes, right? Trident can provide volumes in different access modes. We support read-write-once, read-write-many, read-only. Basically, when we say read-write-many, most of the time we think NFS because you can share one volume between different pods. When we think read-write-once, usually it's more like a one-to-one relationship for a database, for instance. But we also support read-write-once with NFS and read-write-many with iSCSI protocols, so NFS iSCSI. And maybe we will support object storage pretty soon with the COSI standard that is in alpha mode, which stands for Container Object Storage Interface. The goal here is not to create dynamically a volume, but to dynamically create a S3 bucket. When it comes to controlling the storage, well, I mean, you can create quotas or limit for the storage to limit what can be done. You can also control performance because, yeah, this is also important. You don't want to have one pod or one application that uses all the IOs of your storage. You want everything to be shareable. We provide everything to monitor the environment, and you can also import volume back into Kubernetes. That can be an interesting use case. In terms of how to install Trident, well, whatever means you are used to with Kubernetes, Helm charts, operators, GitOps, feel free to adapt Trident to that. We have everything you need. We have an Helm chart available on artifacthub.io. We have an operator available on operatorhub.io for the OpenShift users mostly. And so, yeah, it's available for any flavor you like. In terms of CSI specific features, we support the CSI snapshots and we support the CSI topology. And we support expanding the volumes, which means making them bigger. And finally, Trident is secured in many different layers and fashion, especially, well, for network accesses, who can see what and when, and also for iSCSI, because we can limit exactly who can mount the resources. Now, like I said earlier, I discovered Capsule, I guess, in the last KubeCon, and I started playing with it. And what I really liked was the fact that it's highly customizable. So you can really achieve something very complete with very little work, I guess. So I will show you a live demo. So keep in mind, it's a live demo with a demo environment. So sometimes it's not as fast as I would like it to be. However, here is what I'm going to show you. So my demo environment is composed of a Kubernetes cluster, so vanilla kube, with four different hosts, worker nodes. Underneath, I've got my NetApp storage backend, which has what we call two different SVMs, which stands for storage VM, and which is actually a storage tenant. Each tenant is isolated from others in terms of resources, but it can also be isolated in terms of networking. So I've got two tenants, a pink one, a green one. In my Kubernetes cluster, Capsule is already installed, but anyway, you saw in the previous demo how it is done. And then I will, well, install Trident. I will use the Helm chart for that also. And you will see it takes just a few seconds. And I will configure Trident. I will create two backends, a pink one, a green one, the pink backend being linked to the pink storage tenant and the green one to the green storage tenant. Finally, I will create two storage classes, which are the two Kubernetes objects that are going to be used by the tenant users. Next step, I will create my capsule tenants. I will have two of them. You will see the different parameters I have set. Also, I am limiting them to specific hosts. I'm defining specific storage classes for each one of them. I'm limiting the number of namespace I want to be able to create in them, and so on. And finally, I will create, well, namespaces in these tenants with different applications. And we will see that my persistent volumes are going to be dynamically created on the storage backend. So let's move on to the demo. Hopefully. Okay, so. I was scared for a bit. It's coming. Okay, so and it's working. So I've got my running environment. Again, I've got a Kubernetes cluster with four different nodes. I don't have any tenant just yet, but Capsule is already installed. Trident is not installed yet either. So let's start with that. I will start with by installing Trident. So again, it's done with a Helm chart. It takes about, 15 to 20 seconds. I have put my images locally in my private repo so that it's a little bit faster. And since it follows the CSI specifications, I'm going to have a daemon set. So one pod per node, which has the Trident container and the CSI sidecar, which is the one that is going to talk to the host, the Linux host, and ask this host to mount resources, NFS shares or iSCSI LUNs. Also, I have another pod that has all the other sidecars, which is the CSI snapshot sidecar, the CSI, there are six of them, the provisioner, the snapshot, the volume expansion sidecar, I think also. Like I said, it's a lab environment. So sometimes things are not as fast as I would like to. So I will just show you that I have installed the Trident version from this January. Just because this is the demo I'm used to run. Something I have not said, we have a quarterly release cadence for Trident. The next version is coming at the end of October, so right for KubeCon. And there you go, we have a running Trident right now. Next step is to configure it. Again, I will create two Trident backends, and I will create the corresponding storage classes. It's fully integrated into Kubernetes, so you can do everything with YAML files. There you go. I now have two Trident backends, and I have two storage classes, right? So now I want to create my tenants. So I will show you the different parameters I have set in my first tenant. Oops. There you go. The interesting part is this one here. I am able to specify which storage class I want to use, which means that you really can build an isolated tenant from the Kubernetes pods down to the storage without any hard path. Okay, so let's create the next steps, which is the tenants. So I'm creating two tenants, tenant one and tenant two. I've been pretty inventive here. The first tenant has a quota of three namespaces available, the second one only one. Like I said, I'm limiting my tenants to specific labels, so tenant one and tenant two. And I have already used the shell script provided by CLASTIX to create dynamically my kubeconfig files. Now that I have done that, I can start deploying applications. That's also pretty simple. Let's see how that works. First, can I, as a tenant user, can I list all the namespaces and the storage classes? Actually, no. By default, I don't have the right to do so. I can tweak the system and create different cluster roles to make these visible. That's why you have these errors. So I have, I have created a ghost application, so a blog, if you want. As a tenant owner, I can see the different resources that are mounted in this environment. So you can see here that I have dynamically created a volume right? As a Kubernetes admin, I can also see the different objects, obviously. I just wanted to be sure that everything is running smoothly. So I will just verify that all my objects have been created. And yes, I've got my blog, which is in a running state. It has a new IP address and its volume is managed by Trident. So if I use this IP address here, I'm accessing my application and the data you are actually seeing here comes from the NetApp storage on the backend. Okay, I have created one application in one tenant. Now what I'm going to see, I'm going to create a different application in the other tenant. This one, it's just a busybox pod, something a little bit smaller in its own namespace also. I cannot, as a owner of the second tenant, I can see the objects of the first tenant, obviously. Otherwise, it will not be isolated. It's not the goal. The goal is really to see only what you have. So again, it takes a little bit of time. So I'm just checking. Okay, my busybox pod is running. And it is mounting another volume I have created by Trident. Now I can show you as a kube admin all the different pods I have in my environment. Oops. I currently have two of them for this demo, which is this one here and this one here. The two PVCs I'm showing you the pod. That's not what I wanted to show you. That's better. So I've got my two PVCs, one PVC for the first tenant, another PVC for the second tenant, right? Okay, so next I'm going to create a new application in the first tenant because I have enough quota to create a new namespace and a new application. So this time it's another instance of Ghost in a new namespace. Again, it takes a few seconds to run. And now as a tenant owner, so the first tenant, I can see the first application. Sorry for the typo. It was not tenant two. It's application two. I can see the second application. They're both running in the same tenant, right? In the second namespace I just created, I have all running here. So, as you saw, everything is done dynamically and securely. Now, when you talk about persistent volumes, the step further is to start looking at CSI snapshots, which are some kind of object that runs in Kubernetes. It is some kind of a copy of the PVC object that you can use to either create backups or create copies or clones of your applications. By default, you cannot use this feature. You don't have the right because it has not been implemented by default in the different cluster roles. So what I'm going to do, I am going to create a specific role and apply it to my tenant, the tenant number one. As you can see, I give the rights to create snapshots and to update snapshots. So now in the next step, I'm creating a CSI snapshot. And from this snapshot, I'm going also to create a new volume based on this snapshot. Again, it takes a little bit of time. So I just have to rerun the last command, which is this one. There you go. And now I've got my original PVC. I've got the snapshot I just created. If I were to lose this PVC, well, I still have the snapshot from which I can create a new PVC and restart my application if I want to, right? So I think that's the end of my demo. Yes. So I showed you how to install Trident, how to configure Trident, how to create tenants which points to specific backends. I showed you how to create application within a tenant, which uses persistent volumes. So, and try it yourself. You'll see it is really pretty cool. Back to the presentation. If you want to have more information about Astra Trident and the family of Astra, please look at these different links. I have put here different demo scenarios that are available on my GitHub. Everything I showed you during the demo is available here. And voila, now it's time for you to give it a try. And if you have questions about NetApp, Trident, Kubernetes, or Astra, well, I'm here to answer them anytime.
Thank you so much, Yves. It was really enjoyable. And thanks also for the mention, because I've been there regarding this storage and something that is really, really interesting. Also, taking a look to the new feature regarding the snapshot of the storage, because in the past, I was working with storage and Kubernetes. And you know, running at scale is always really, really tricky. And since you were talking also regarding the COSI, COSI, maybe do you have further insights regarding this new specification? Maybe that could be interesting, because it's not the first time I already heard about that, but you know, Kubernetes is so huge. There are so many special interest groups. So do you have maybe more insights regarding the this announcement proposal, and also how NetApp works with the object storage? Because you were mentioning S3, so I guess that Trident is going to create an S3 compatible storage, right?
So yeah, so COSI was supposed to be released earlier, but with COVID it was delayed. COSI, yes, the goal is to create dynamically S3 buckets. When it comes to NetApp, we have two different object storage solutions, depending on the use case, the geographical location. If you want a small environment or something huge to have a super secured grid across 12 data centers, we also have that. I don't know yet if it is Trident itself that is going to be compatible with COSI or something new. I don't know. However, I'm waiting for KubeCon next week to learn more about COSI, because I'm pretty sure that we will have more information coming. but that will be the next thing, because obviously today you can connect an application to an S3 grid, external, no issue. However, it is a shared grid, or you have to pre-configure it like you would for the storage in the old times. With COSI, everything being dynamic, it will be much better, I believe.
More cloud native, I'd say. Yeah. In the end, you're totally performing the full life cycle of storage with Kubernetes primitives. So that's absolutely great.
And once we have it at NetApp, I believe we may be one of the only storage vendor who can provide file, block, and object storage with one platform. With one CSI driver. We'll see. Crossing my fingers.
yeah. And also keep in mind that we got also Adriano that has a strong background also regarding data on Kubernetes. But I got a final question, so I then mute myself, because otherwise I'm going to monopolize the meeting. And please, people, if you have any question, don't be shy. Open your microphone or type in the chat, and we are forwarding that to Yves. But the question is Trident also able to copy data from maybe a Kubernetes cluster to another one, or is using a different platform? If you have also maybe any caveats or any experience so far that you face to share with the community regarding that.
About moving the data. So you can picture Trident as a vertical provisioner. You have Trident, it will create a volume underneath it. If you want to move the physical volume. We have all the features in our systems to do that. However, Kubernetes has to follow up, right? So there are different ways to do so. If it comes, if it is only about the PVC itself that we want to move, we can use the NetApp features to move that from one NetApp platform to the next NetApp platform, no issue. However, keep in mind that there is also the application on top of the PVC, and comes in the picture the consistency of this application, because when you take a snapshot of a volume, well, it may be incomplete. And here I am referring to mostly databases, because they don't write bulk on the drive at every single moment of time. They have cache and buffer in play. So if you take a snapshot, it will be useless, because you cannot backup it, you cannot restore it, you cannot clone it. So you need to have a tool, a solution that can interact with both the storage and the application, right? So that when you take a snapshot, you just ask first the application to put all the blocks on the drive. So for a hot backup, a crisis mode, a freeze mode, whatever mode you whatever word talks to you. And for that specifically, we have something called Astra Control, part of the Astra family. And my goal, after having tested Trident with CLASTIX, my next step is to test Astra Control with Capsule also, because I'm pretty sure that I can achieve something nice.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Anyway, now I mute myself, because otherwise I can talk for hours.
No. Me too.
Thank you so much again. And Marcello, maybe do you want to open your microphone? Just a friendly reminder for the...
Yeah, guys, you have been amazing. Thanks so much, Yves. You have been really a great host. I think we are few, but all the people appreciated this very much. And I'm sure this video will rack up some really good views in the days to come. And guys, thank you very much for being here. You could have been outside to grab a cocktail or have aperitif, but you are here with us. So we got a little prize. So if you fill up the form that I've just linked, you get a chance to get a virtual pass for KubeCon if you cannot manage to get there. So please feel free to share.
Yeah, and I think that we can wrap up here the meeting. So again, thank you so much, Yves, and thank you so much also Marcello and all the people that attended the year. So looking forward for KubeCon of America 2022. And cheers, I'd say. Bye-bye. Ciao a tutti.
Ciao.
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 Thanks,
grazie.
Everyone.
Ciao.
Oh.